I don't know about you, but I feel a new excitement. There's something happening, isn't there? Some wonderful things are happening, and I just love the carols and what's happening and the connections with the community, which is our hope and desire. I love how God is touching people's lives individually, and we've had a smattering of them today. And I know that if I got you one-on-one and say, tell me what God is doing in your life, that many of you would be able to tell me remarkable stories. And I guess I'd like us to think further into that. I love what Phil was talking about, that story. What is the story you're going to be left with? And you would think that we've actually compared notes today, but because I guess that's what I would like us to think about, the story we're going to be writing with our lives. Well, today I'd want to think about the journey of how we as the people of God move on in faith and trusting in our Father. A few weeks ago, I spoke about the bad things that COVID has taught us. You know, anxiety, where people are trapped in their fears of the seen and unseen, and isolation, how we've been taught not to actually touch each other anymore. We stay away from each other. Hoarding and fear of commitment, how volunteers have vanished in not just in community activities, but in the church. I spoke about tiredness and missing out. And I think the attitudes of the formers, sometimes we've been formed these attitudes that we've got excuses to be lazy. We've got indulgences that we have to do because we feel that we're hard done by. It's easier not to do something. It'd be so much easier not to have carols, wouldn't it? It'd be so easy. Imagine we could have a bit of a smooth run up to Christmas and it'd be so easy not to have carols. An attitude that, you know, like somehow watching a church service on YouTube is somehow fulfilling my commitment to God's kingdom. I mean, we've got to move away. And I guess that's, you know, when the church leaders and the ministry leaders, we spoke about not cancelling church. We did that because I guess we've been taught that church can be cancelled at a drop of a hat. And actually, we're saying, well, no, we're coming out of that way of thinking. We're leaving that way of thinking behind. And God willing, whenever we can, if two or three can gather here at 9:30 on a Sunday morning, praise God. Let's open the church. The same at 5 p.m. We're not going to be just cancelling that. It's just drop of the hat. We're moving beyond that. We want to leave that stuff behind. Been talking with the church leaders and ministry team leaders, and it's like I'm trying to use the illustration, it's like we're coming out of the winter into spring. Something new is happening. There's a new era that is happening. And the spring has not just been the COVID period of the last 2 and a bit years. It's also, let's recognise, the loss of the Evans family. This left us with a sadness, and we feel like it's been a winter time. But we need to move on. We need to leave the winter behind. I know times such as this does cause people to rethink, you know, to rethink about, do I stay a part of this community? There's been changes. But let me encourage you that the community is not about Phil Evans. As much as I love the guy, it is about Jesus Christ and his people coming together. You are the community. You are the church. I guess that's what I'd like to explore something of today. I got this little illustration from Kylie Morgan, suggested that she's a creative person, I'm not. But so I've got a little video clip I want to show you, 1 minute, which illustrates, some of you will know it, most of you will probably know it, but I'm hoping the YouTube clip will come up in 3, 2, 1, I don't know. I just love Narnia. Do you remember that's part of the story where there was always winter and there's never Christmas and they were stuck in this winter, and then they came to a place where it started thawing. The winter seemed to be diminishing and spring was coming. Kylie also, just in my regular meeting with the leaders and the chaplains, in Isaiah 61 verse 3 and 4, she pointed this out to me. She talks about the hope that we have, about those provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. It's not ashes we're going to remain in. There's this crown of beauty, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. That's got to be us. That's got to be us as we live out this hope. They'll be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They'll renew their ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. Well, we don't have ruins here, but you know what I'm trying to get across? The idea that actually we need to rebuild. We need to actually focus on rebuilding. And it's going to take us to do it. I want to reflect upon who we are as a church. And so I've gone back to one of my favourite passages, and it's going to be 1 Peter chapter 2. And it's going to be verse 4 and 5. And we're going to just go through this a little bit slowly because I think it's just so important for us to understand who we are. And so Peter wrote, "As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ." This highlights to me that we need the Spirit of God working in our lives, because it says, as we come, as you come to him, it is as we come, as we move towards Jesus Christ, this happens. And what happens when we move towards Jesus Christ on this journey, and it's not just sort of standing on a conveyor belt, we are actually moving forward, we are being built into this spiritual house. Paul says that we are the temple of God, that we collectively are the temple of God. He also talks about the individual believer who has the Spirit of God. You are the temple of God, but here we see we collectively are the temple of God. We are built with living stones, no dead ones. And what's a living stone? It's got to be one that needs to be shaped for purpose. As we come, we are to be built into this spiritual house. And we can, and it's right for us to think about HVBC being that spiritual house, but you know, we're a part of a bigger spiritual house. There is the church universal, which we could think of ourselves as just one part of that living stone in that temple. We are a part of being built. We are the body of Christ. We are the priesthood. The Catholic Church got it all wrong when they identified one person to be the priest. Because you know what? We all are that priesthood. We represent to people of the world God. Does that worry you a bit? That it's up to us to represent God to our world? Every believer is a priest because we declare this good news. Look at verse 5. We are to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. What's these spiritual sacrifices? It's not money. It's spiritual sacrifice. It's not time. It's not even energy. Our spiritual sacrifice is our act of worship, as we give our whole lives. Everything we have, we give to God as a spiritual sacrifice to honor him, because you know why? He's worth it. He is worth it. Our life of praise and worship, praise to God, is our worship. He already has our lives. If you claim Jesus is Lord, that doesn't mean Jesus is just the facilitator. He's not the organizer. He is Lord, the boss, the king. and we look at the cross, there is nothing else to pay because he took our sins on us, on himself. And when in the resurrection, he was declared to be Lord, and he is the one we want to associate ourselves. We want to be found in Christ. So Peter brings all these things in a remarkable way, and he uses words really that only should be attributed to Israel. But what he says to the true Israel in verse 9, he says, "You, the church, are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you've received mercy." Look at verse 9. A chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special position. This was the Old Testament language of Israel. We are God's chosen people. When we look at the word holy there, we need to remember there's two aspects of holy. Holy means certainly moral. We're doing the right thing. We're living lives that are right and proper. But holy in this case is also, it says, we are actually God's special possession. We are set aside for God. So in the temple, they would have these remarkable golden dishes and bowls. You know, the priest didn't take that home after the service to have a picnic with. That was dedicated for the temple because it was special, it was holy, it was set apart. The cups and utensils were holy, they were set apart. They were God's special possession used for his special reason. And you and I are called holy to the Lord. He owns us, and we are to be set aside for his special purposes. I was never a good student, particularly of English and grammar, but look at verse 9, and I'm really impressed my English teacher, if she could see me. Verse 9, there is a purpose clause. Now, what's a purpose clause? A purpose clause shows, what's the purpose of this? Why is it so? It defines what is trying to be achieved. But that's the purpose that God sets. Look at the sentence. Do you see the purpose clause in verse 9? Would someone like to, let me be an English teacher, would someone like to tell me what the purpose clause here is? That you may declare your purpose. He's done this so that you might declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. So let me ask you, how are you going about living your purpose? That's your purpose. That's your purpose, that you may declare the praises in your own life, in your family. What about your community, your workplace? What about your church? Are you living out your... When have you done it last? Do you have to think back days, weeks, months, years? When will you live out your purpose of declaring the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light? I want to think about who determines who we are. Well, it's God, isn't it? He's the creator. We are his people. But who determines what we are intended for? Again, it has to be God. I've got a picture of Albert Bernard Noble when he was a young man and when he was an old man. He's a Swedish chemist, he's the guy for the Nobel Peace Prize. He's the one who established it. He's a scientist, and this ran the 1860s, around the 1860s, 1870s. He was the one who created dynamite. Okay, before that, you remember the old westerns where they used to talk about nitroglycerin, and they'd be scared because of, you're going to bump the nitroglycerin, you're going to blow up everyone because it was so unstable. But Noble, what he did was he created dynamite, which was really safe, so that when construction and mining had to happen, people didn't die just because they bumped the dynamite. Well, Noble had an interesting experience when his brother died in 1888 or something. a lot of the papers got to hear that Noble died, and they got the wrong one. They actually thought it was this guy here, not his brother. And so those papers actually wrote the obituary of his obituary. And do you know what they said? They said he was a warmonger. They said he was creating new ways, better ways to kill people, because that's the way dynamite was used. You could blow people up. So he got to read his own obituary before he died. And he was determined his name, Noble, wasn't going to be associated with war and death. So he established the Nobel Peace Prize and devoted all his wealth after he died. I don't know how his family thought about that, but after he died, all his wealth was dedicated for the Nobel Peace Prize. And that's where we get it today. His name is associated with peace, not death. There's two things I want to draw from this, and it sort of goes back to Phil. What's your story that you're going to be known for? What is your story that you're going to be known for? Not many of us are going to have the opportunity to read our own obituaries, but what's the story you're going to be known for? I don't know whether this guy actually as a believer or not. And it's really wonderful that he had the opportunity to change that perception of his on a human level, but he still had to face God the Creator, didn't he? His judge. I don't know what his story was. The second thing is I'm just really aware that sometimes things can be invented for good and abused. They can be taken and used in different ways. You think of painkillers. Boy, if you're sick and you're suffering, painkillers are a wonderful thing, aren't they? But I'm sure even amongst a group like this, there's some of us who are abusing painkillers, medication. We might be using them too often. We might be, because they can be abused. I was once an electrician, of course, and my main tools were pliers and screwdriver. But you know what? They made the best hammer and chisel when you didn't have a. We used to use it for the wrong thing. It wasn't the intention, but you use it. And I'm just wondering. I want to ask the question: what are you using church for? What are you using church for? A place of friendship? Is that what it is? This is. Is it a place where I can be inspired and sing some songs and enjoy that? For many of us, particularly with children, maybe it's a place where you hope the children are going to be conforming to some sort of ethic, morals that you've got. A place where you can come and be served. The people, you feel really valued here. And that's what it's, when you come here, you're just so thankful that you can be served and people find they encourage you. It's a place to find purpose. Place for encouragement. If that's your main purpose, you've made church an idol. That's idol worship. You're trying to achieve your own ends. Now, I would hope that all those things happen for us all. It is happening, but we need to make sure that we keep the main thing the main thing. We need to make sure. So let me, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. This is very well known by many of us. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we reach unity of faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of God. You see, the body is the church is the body of Christ. Because Jesus is not here on earth today. He once was, but he now has put a body in place, and you know what? We're a part of that body. We represent Christ to our world. That is what we do. But what's why is another purpose clause here, isn't it? Verse 12. Why did Christ give those gifts? To equip his people for works of service. so that the body of Christ may be built up. So I know that Phil and Peter and Jenny are really happy to get people to volunteer, and we do think that it's a wonderful way to serve the community, but it is also a real way that we build each other up in the body of Christ by serving and serving in sacrificial ways. It talks about unity in faith, unity in the knowledge of the Son of God. We need to be mature. People who come here just to take are not the mature ones, are they? The mature come to serve and to love and to care, attain the whole measure of the fullness of God. Can you just, does that blow your mind? We are meant to attain the fullness of Christ. What is that? The work of the Spirit of God seeks to, and the body of Christ works to, for us to attain the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. You can't have that when you watch YouTube, can you? A church of YouTube. There's no way that you can show your love. There's no way you can serve others. So we as a church, we exist to make disciples, beginning with unreached people, ending with passionate, mature followers of Jesus Christ. It's time to recognise that winter's over, spring's here. You may not have picked up in the clip, but you know what? Remember the kids were first had the jackets on? They had the big furry jackets, and as they came to the edge where there's sort of winter and spring, they sort of opened it up, and then towards the spring, in the spring, they actually left those jackets behind. There are things we need to leave behind if we're going to move forward. I was with one of the group of pastors during the week, and one of the pastors of a very large church, he's actually moved from the church. He's got another role now, but he's sort of connected to his old church. And there's this woman there who was actually one of the guns of volunteers. You know, if you wanted something done, you go and see her. She was just the one who was always involved and was a real leader in the church. But since COVID, she's not really taken that role up again. She's not done that. And so he said to her, let's call her Susan. Susan, what's the problem? Like, you don't seem to be involved. And so I've just filled my life up with other things, was her excuse. It's easy for us to point the finger at her, but I just sort of wonder how many other things we've filled up our lives with. Over the next few months, I'm talking with church leaders and ministry leaders. We're working through how we can have a real focus, better focus for next year. We're not just going to sort of mark time. How do we live out our calling in 2023? Some people argue that the book of Acts really was not finished. You know, it's chapter 28, but the story of Acts is really the story of the church's growth. But we shouldn't call it the Acts of the Apostle. We should call it the Acts of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is pushing the believers along. But I want us to think of, like, we're going to be writing Acts chapter 2023 next year. You know, the Spirit of God is going to write in us a new chapter. And it's going to be a part of that story. So I've got a couple of questions. Few questions. Would you dare to believe that the Spirit of God will write a new chapter in HVC next year? Are you willing to believe that you will have a part in that chapter? What will it take for you to be a part of that story? And are you willing to be used by God to engage God's work for God's kingdom? Four questions. But it's all around the same thing, isn't it? Would you dare to believe that this new chapter is going to be written by the Holy Spirit? Are you willing to believe that you've got a part in it? Please don't leave it up to the ministry of the team leaders or the church leaders. It's we collective, we the body of Christ is needed. But what will it take for you to be a part of that story. There will be a spiritual sacrifice of life, of passion. The things that maybe we've filled our lives up with in the last 3 years to get through, we're leaving it behind. And it may come at a cost. Are you willing to be used by God to engage in God's work for God's kingdom? I think it's going to be four out, and this is the discussion, there's four areas. We're going to be thinking about your relationship with Jesus, because that's where it all starts from. Just 2 weeks ago, I'm talking with Wendy, I just came to see that actually, you know what? I was not pursuing the joy of the Lord intentionally enough in my life. I was not doing that intentionally. I was reading the Bible, I was praying, but I was not pursuing the joy of the Lord. But, you know, Nehemiah says, the joy of the Lord is my strength. So, you know, what I was feeling a bit weak and tired, and you know why? Because I wasn't pursuing the joy of the Lord, which is my strength. So we're going to be talking about Jesus. We're going to be talking about your relationship with Jesus. We're going to be thinking about you intentionally in engaging with your family for the kingdom's sake. We want you to think about your community or your workplace. Many of you spend 45 to 50 hours with other people. There's a community. How are you going to engage in that? And the fourth thing I think we're going to be thinking about is how we engage the church, how we be the church in 2023, not in 2021. We're leaving that behind. Over the next 6 weeks, we're going to be looking through what it means for us as a community to be moving forward. And we're going to look at the values of faith, hope, and love. And I just came across this passage, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. Let me read to you. We remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. What does that remind you of? Something up there? And the thing I love about it is, what produces work? Not effort. It is faith. What does it mean for us to have faith moving forward? It says, it talks about endurance. What inspired endurance? Hope. And what prompts love? What prompts labor? Love. So this is sort of a bit of a battle cry. It's a bit of a call to arms. I want you to get ready. There's some of you who need to acknowledge Jesus as Lord and be baptized. Because I want you to be ready. There's some of you who need to acknowledge Jesus as Lord. I'm telling you where we're going. I'm not sure exactly all the points, but this is the gist. It's the marbo of the idea. It's a call to acknowledge Jesus as your Lord. So if that's you, I want you to talk with someone that you know, that you trust. Tell them, I want to acknowledge Jesus as Lord. And the call is to be baptized. We haven't had a baptism for a while, have we? It's about time we had another baptism. The Spirit of God working in lives. But also there's some people who have been fluffing around who have not been baptized. Well, what's stopping you? What's stopping you being baptized? Okay? So come and see me after the service. We'll have a baptism service before the end of the year. I guarantee it. But you need to make a step. It's time to get ready. I want you to pursue joy in Jesus more intentionally. I want you to actively, so what that means for me is I wake up in the middle of the night, 2 o'clock, and I just think, I just want to enjoy the fact that my Father in heaven has protected me. I sit and I think about the wonders and the joy of the Lord. I seek to intentionally feed myself in areas of biblical knowledge and understanding. So I read, I podcast. Maybe I listen to more sermons than anyone else here in this room. Pursue the joy of the Lord more. And I'd like you to prepare yourself to serve. there's a wonderful opportunity here in the next 10 minutes to hear about opportunities to serve. I love that. What's the story that you're writing? A part of pursuing Jesus, Lord, is this. I've got 150 places on this app where people can join me as we read the scriptures together. If anyone took their phone out and scanned the QR code, they'd be straight there, but it's online. Let me encourage you. Let's read, let's think, let's ponder what it means for us to be a church of faith, hope, and love in 2023. So there's a call to arms. We are the body of Christ. The church will not do that if we don't move. If it's up to us as we seek. But the first thing we need to do is seek passion and love of Jesus. So I'm going to pray and we'll conclude this morning. So Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we just want to acknowledge you right now. Lord, we want to acknowledge that you are our Father, our Lord, and our Comforter. Lord, what would we be without you? Where would we be? Lord, I want to thank you that you've patient with us. For the times we've used our excuses, we've excused ourselves because of maybe fear or anxiety to step out in obedience. We felt tired, so we chose not to love. It was easier not to. Lord, as we come out of this era, as we come out of this season, Lord, we want to leave behind the things that we used for our comfort, because we want to move forward in the hope that you call us out. Holy Spirit, would you work within us? Would you create in me a clean heart? Would you renew a loyal spirit within me? Would you restore the joy of your salvation? And Lord, would you make me willing to obey? Because you know, Lord, there are times when I don't even want to obey. Would you make me willing to obey? So Lord, I want to pray for those who need to get right with you. They need to acknowledge Jesus as Lord. Would you please prompt the hearts of those here to reach out to someone that they trust and they know? Lord, for those of us who need to be obedient and be baptized, Lord, we are asking for baptisms before the end of the year. Before the carols start, Lord, may we see many of us be baptized. Lord, would you help us as we pursue your joy in you and step out in faith, Lord, spiritual sacrifices. May we offer them to you. Lord, may we not count the cost, because the cost of not following you is far worse. Holy Spirit, would you continue to work and shape us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I just like a blessing. Could you please stand? There's this wonderful passage in 1 Thessalonians 3. Now listen to this blessing. It's a blessing. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus Christ clear the way for us to come to you. That's what Paul was saying. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. May he strengthen your heart so that you may be blameless and holy in the presence of God our Father when our Lord Jesus Christ comes with all his holy ones. Amen. We're going to have morning tea now, so please come and join. Don't forget this spot over here. Great opportunity. And let's just enjoy each other's company as we finish up today.